Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Spirit of Life Parish. This weekend we celebrate the 24th Sunday in ordinary time. Please stand and join us in our opening song, Christ the King.
Thank you. of God, creator and ruler of all things, that we may feel the working of your mercy, grant that we may serve you with all our heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
My cheeks to those who plucked my
said to him in reply, "You are the Christ." Then he warned them not to tell anyone about him. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer greatly and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, to be killed, and rise after 3 days. He spoke this openly. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. At this he turned around, and looking at his disciples, rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are thinking not as God does, but as human beings do." He summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and that of the gospel will save it." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
I got up this morning. I could have stayed in bed all day, just enjoy the warmth, the softness of the pillow. I got up this morning, and I came over here, and I lost the opportunity to make myself a very nice breakfast. Pancakes, lots of cream, choke cherry syrup, nice eggs, bacon. Lost that chance. I could just ease into the day. But instead I give my day to masses, all day at masses, something I have to do all day, because for some reason, I pick this job. I could have just sat up in a chair on the lawn and just enjoy the nice view. Signs that came out. I could sit there all day and just read a book. The whole day could have been mine. But I lost them. And so, as I look at you, as I think about my day and what it could have been, I think, what a bunch of losers. What a bunch of losers. Whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and that of the gospel will save it. This is what Jesus says today. He called you a loser. No, he didn't. He called you to be a loser. And under all of that, in order for us for that to make any sense at all, he asks us a question that we must answer. If we don't answer that question, and we don't answer correctly, then we're losers in the sense that somebody might call us a loser because we went to church on Sunday. Because of all the things we lost. And by the way, you don't have to just be a loser by going to church on Sunday. You can be a loser by saying your daily prayers, because that takes time. You can be a loser by taking care of your family. You can be a loser by going to work. You can be a loser by doing anything that you don't want to do, but you think is a good idea. You can be a loser in a lot of ways. And so we have to answer the question not just by answering it, but we have to answer it correctly. Because there are those who don't answer it correctly. And so they think by answering it, they become not losers. What's the question? You just heard it, right? Who do you say that I, Jesus, who Jesus is. Who do you say that I am? Jesus asks you that question. And you have to answer it in your heart, in your mind, in your soul, in your strength, and in your whole life. You have to answer that question, because if you don't answer that question, you've given an answer. Who do you say that I am? Well, you're not important enough for me to answer the question. I have other things to do. Or we can say, who do you say that I am? You have a Christ. What does that mean? Because many of the people who answered that question heard, you are the Christ, and that means that any trouble in my life, you're going to take care of it. If I'm sick, you'll heal me. If I'm sad, you'll make me happy. If I'm sore, you'll tend my wounds. If I don't like my job, you'll get me a different one. If I don't make enough money, you'll get me more money. You'll cause me to win the lottery. If I don't like my family, then you'll let me move away, far, far away. If I don't like my pastor, you'll let me not pay attention to him when he's giving a song. But here's the thing. Jesus isn't that kind of Christ. And he makes that clear because he says what I just read. And right before that he says, I'm the kind of Christ who's going to suffer for you. I'm the kind of Christ who's going to give up my life. I'm not going to jump on a horse, ride into Jerusalem, and kill everybody you don't like. Or take away everything you don't like and set up heaven on earth for just you. And let the others all stand outside. I'm going to take up my cross. What are you going to do? And by the way, when Jesus says, I'm going to take up my cross, and when Peter hears him say, I'm going to take up my cross, and when Jesus tells us to take up our cross, he isn't saying what we usually think of. Oh, I got tennis elbow. That's my cross. Yeah, that's a little cross, I suppose. I'm giving up strawberries, fresh strawberries and chocolate for Lent. That's my cross. My children are cranky. That's my cross. My spouse is mad at me. That's my cross. No, when Peter and Jesus are talking about the cross in this gospel, they're thinking about the people that they've seen the Romans crucified by the rope. They're thinking of the horrible, suffocating, burning pain and humiliating death that the Romans put people to, and that both of them would suffer. They're talking about a literal cross. They're talking about giving a whole life. Now, mortifications aren't nothing. Offering the little sufferings of our life to God aren't nothing, and they can help us to prepare for the greater sufferings in our life. But in the end, what Jesus and Peter are talking about and what Jesus is inviting us to is not simply the loss of a few moments or even a whole hour. What Jesus is saying is, I am going to give you my life. And what are you going to do about it? I'm going to give you everything. And that means you owe me everything. Everything. Now, Peter doesn't like that answer. So he takes him aside and says, Jesus, you know, if you are going to suffer on the cross, that means I'm going to suffer. And I don't want that. He's also saying, Jesus, I love you, but I don't want you to suffer. He's not cruel. But so often our response to Jesus is, Jesus, I don't want to suffer. I don't want to lose anything. Jesus says, anyone who wants to follow me must take up his cross. And that means not just the apostles, all of whom died. And that means not just our ancestors, all of whom have died. And some of whom have died martyred. But all of us. All of us. And so, I wrote down, I was thinking about this. If we're going to be losers, we've got to be good losers. So I wrote down some questions that I thought, oh, these questions will help you and me to take them to prayer and figure out what kind of losers God, we should be. Whoever saves his life, remember the last part of that, whoever saves his life in this world will lose it. So these center around saving your life. And if you're like Peter comes to Jesus and he wants to save Jesus from the cross. What in your life are you saving Jesus from? And I ask that because as a matter of fact, most of the time, we're like Peter in the worst part of what Peter's doing. And that is, what we're doing is we're not trying to really to save Jesus from anything. We're trying to save Jesus. We're trying to save us from carrying our cross. So what part of the cross are you saying, Jesus, I need to save you from that? I'm not gonna suffer that because that makes my life more comfortable. How about this? What are you saving from Jesus? And the easiest example to think of that is like, what are we saving from our parents? Or what are we saving from our spouse? You know, the things that we don't tell them. The things that we don't let them know about. Because it saves us from some trouble. Actually, if you're saving anything from Jesus, if you're keeping anything away from Jesus, you can be sure there's sin there. You can be absolutely sure that Jesus, to whom we owe our whole life, either wants to help you with it, or wants to give you the grace to get through it. But if we hold it back for ourselves and we're hiding it, then we can be sure that there's some sin there somewhere. How about this? What is Jesus asking you to lose right now in your life? What is Jesus asking you to lose right now in your life? Is it some time to help out at the outreach kitchen? Is it some time to use skills that you have to make things nicer here at the parish? Is it some skill that you have that you look around, you walk in the Spirit of Life, and you say, I sure wish somebody would fix that. Drives me crazy. I do that every day, and it drives me absolutely crazy that Father won't get that fixed. Father probably hasn't even noticed it. You have the skills. You have the knowledge. Why don't you use it? Maybe it's the biblical tithe. Maybe God says to you, you never give anything but a dollar to the church. And you should probably do more than that because you make $1 million a month. Because you're a TikTok star. I'm on Facebook every week. But I don't make $1 million. Maybe it's money. Maybe it's your talent. Maybe it's your treasure. Maybe it's that you have a neighbor who can't mow her lawn anymore. And out of love for Jesus, you could. Maybe it's a brother that you could pray for, or a sister. What is Jesus asking you to lose right now? I think I'm giving you examples, but in the end, you have to go back into your own heart, your own mind, and your own life and ask that question, because it's not what I'm asking. It's what Jesus is asking that's important here. How about this one? What are you saving for later? You know, I always wanted to do this for the church, or I always wanted to do this for God, or I always wanted to do this for my spouse, whom I love, whom Jesus married me to her, to him. I always wanted to do this for my children. I always wanted to do this for my community. And someday, I'll have the time. Or someday, I'll have enough. Right now, I have enough, but I have to get more so that I'll have enough plus enough. Because that's the way we do it, right? I need to have enough, but I need to have the extra that's enough so that I can give away the enough. What are you saving for later? So, what's really interesting about today's gospel is that Jesus wants us to become the biggest losers that we know. Because he is the kind of Messiah who lost everything for us and for the healing of our sins and to give us life. Jesus does want to give us life. But not the same old life that we had when we were in the middle of our sin. Jesus wants to give us life, but not whatever life we want. Jesus wants us to get not a life, but his life. Whatever we say, we lose. And the cross is a necessary part of our life. Who do you say that I am?
And penance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For members of our community.
mercy and compassion through the merits of our Savior, hear the prayers of your church, confessing with Peter our faith in Christ your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We invite the children to make their offering by coming forward and placing it in the basket. Joy, we acclaim.
offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts you have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you.
Amen.
by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom of power and glory are yours now and
forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever.
Amen."
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Yeah.
Let us pray. May the working of this heavenly gift, O Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies, so that its effects and not our own desires may always prevail in us through Christ our Lord. But it does cost more than a lot.